Tonight I'd like to discuss two aspects of Tisha B'Av. This year Tisha B'Av is coming after Shabbos, so the Suda Mafsekes we don't have. Usually we have a Suda Mafsekes, which is the meal that precedes Tisha B'Av. It's a mafsek, it separates between the days of eating, the times that are regular, and it separates to the times that you cannot eat. So this year we don't have that. As the Gemara says, you can eat Kisudasa Shal Shlomo HaMelech. You can have a loaded up Suda at Shal Shittas, and that's what people do at the third meal on Shabbos. They generally have whatever they want to eat. The good question is, the reason why you can do this, the reason why you can eat this, is because of the fact that you can't have any form of avelus, any form of mourning on Shabbos. So if that's so, the question is, if you usually have on Shal Shittas 10 pieces of fish and 25 different salads, so then this Shabbos you would have also 10 pieces of fish, 25 different salads. Should you have less? If you have less, it might be indicative that you're not treating appropriately and you're giving some sort of sign of mourning. Question is, can you actually have more? Can you serve more than you would usually serve because of the fact that now you're going out of the way to preparing, as if almost if you're preparing for the fast, you're not showing that it's your regular Shal Shittas. It seems that the consensus would be that people just eat extra this particular Shal Shittas because they have this fear that they're going to be hungry for the next day, even though they just stuffed their face the entire Shabbos. And in any other regular Shal Shittas, you'd be like, you want to eat? I can barely eat challah. How many times do you want to skip Shal Shittas? But this Shal Shittas, they somehow found room to be able to eat because of the fact that they're just worried about that they're not going to be able to handle the next 24 hours, right? And so we know that once Yom Kippur starts, once Tisha B'Av starts, people just get nervous about the fast. They just finished eating 5 minutes ago, but they're already starting to feel hungry. They're starting to get hunger pains, even though they just finished eating. So this is obviously a psychological issue that we have to deal with. But at Shal Shittas, this year, since it's on Shabbos, you'll eat regular, and that would bring us into, you don't have a Suda Mafsekes, so we don't have to learn the laws this year of Suda Mafsekes, but you have a regular meal. When it comes to eating on Tisha B'Av, so let's keep in mind two major points that we have. On Tisha B'Av, there are five prohibitions that we have, and even no matter how religious or irreligious a person is, they should try to do their best to make sure that they are fulfilling these things on Tisha B'Av. Whether they understand the destruction of the temple or they don't understand, they say maybe, you know, it was 2,000 years ago, famous line from Napoleon, that Napoleon came and saw a group of Jews sitting on the floor mourning on a Tisha B'Av, and he said, what are you doing? And they were crying, and he said, we're mourning. What are you mourning over? What are you suffering for? And he said, we're suffering for our temple that was destroyed. When was it destroyed? Over 2,000 years ago. 2,000 years ago, and you're still mourning for that? And Napoleon said to these Jews, I don't remember who they were, he said, any nation that can mourn for something that happened 2,000 years ago will be a nation that's going to last. If you can actually connect to your past and that, then you will be able to live for eternity. And so therefore, it's important for us to realize that on Tisha B'Av, whether I'm super religious, not religious, don't even know if I'm Jewish, well, okay, you have to know if you're Jewish, then you should take upon yourself these five afflictions. The five afflictions that we have, one of the major ones, of course, as we know, is fasting. That fast begins at sunset on Saturday night, it's coming Saturday night, and goes all the way till nightfall Sunday night. Something for a person to keep in mind, that you push yourself in order to be able to fast on this 25-hour fast. It may seem difficult, especially if you're not used to it. One should push themselves by doing this. You are becoming part of the Jewish nation. You're becoming not just part of the Jewish nation that, let's say, you know, eats gefilte fish, and that's why I'm part of the Jewish nation, but I'm part of the Jewish nation because of the fact that I'm part of the history and the legacy of the Jewish people, and that creates a sense of continuity, not just for myself, for my family as well. Therefore, a person should do whatever they can to ensure that they will be fasting those 25 hours. Yet there are some people that don't actually have to fast on Tisha B'Av. So who are those people that don't have to fast on Tisha B'Av? Non-Jews? Good answer. Survey says, one. Right? So, non-Jews are one people that don't have to fast. Anti-Semites who are not Jewish also don't have to fast, but if they're Jewish, they still have to fast. If they're Jewish, they still have to fast. Even if you're an anti-Semite, you still have to fast. Right? So, who are the people that could potentially be absolved from fasting? The people that are potentially absolved from fasting is someone who's extremely sick. If you're sick, again, we consider this to be a rabbinic fast because it's after the temples are destroyed. So if a person is sick, then they technically would not have to fast. So how do you determine that level of sickness that a person has? If a person is in such a dire state, the doctors say that a person needs to eat, well, then it would be a problem for them to fast. And therefore, in that case, they should actually be eating in those particular scenarios. We have scenarios that a muberes someone who is pregnant or someone who's fasting, even someone who's pregnant or someone who's nursing, even they have to fast. Just like Yom Kippur, they have to fast. These two fasts, Yom Kippur and Tisha B'Av, are what we call the big fast, the big daddies of fast. They both are 25-hour fast. So even a pregnant woman, even a woman who's nursing, they would need to fast. In particular scenarios where fasting would endanger them, so they would eat less than the required amount in order to continue the fast. So if a person drank less than 1 ounce of liquid, it would still be considered as if you're fasting. So 1 ounce we usually consider to be like a shot glass. The person felt that, I don't have the strength. So you drink a less than 1 ounce of Gatorade, it's not as considered as if you've eaten a required amount of food, and therefore that's okay. Similarly, if you took a shot glass, some would suggest a shot glass, and stuffed food into that, maybe that would fall under the category of a kazayas, and eating less than that would be okay. Basically, say less than 28 grams would be enough that a person still considered fasting, even if they ate that food, still considered fasting. If a person has to take medication, so if they have to take medication, let's say a person is on antibiotics, they can take that medication. Let's say they have to take liquid of that medication, they'd be able to take a little bit of liquid in order to get that down. So a person has headaches and severe headaches and the like, and they need to take some medication with that. You try to do it without liquid. If you need to with liquid, you would be able to. Not soapy water, not like Yom Kippur, unless you like soapy water. But on Yom Kippur, there's a way to be poging the flavor, but on Tisha B'Av, you don't necessarily have to do that. You would drink less than an ounce, basically, in order to do that for Tisha B'Av. If there is a person that happens to be sick and cannot fast for whatever reason, so in that scenario that he can't fast, he would actually eat a regular amount. Unlike in Yom Kippur, a person tries to eat less than the required amount. Here, once your fast is broken because of sickness, it means you're absolved from fasting. You're not included in the requirement of fasting, so therefore you're technically off the hook and you would eat normally. You wouldn't necessarily go out of your way and be like, wow, there's no lines at the restaurant, let's go. You know, you would eat a regular way. You wouldn't actually eat too much more. But again, the fasting is different than that in Yom Kippur, and therefore, technically, once you have to break it, you could break it. Children do not have to fast, and don't fast generally on Tisha B'Av. There is no requirement to fast three fasts before your bar mitzvah. Basically, a child is not obligated in any form of mourning whatsoever, so therefore, they don't have to fast at all. So even if their bar mitzvah is coming up, or bas mitzvah is coming up, Tisha B'Av is not necessarily a fast that they actually have to fast for. So according to many, it's an issur. But they shouldn't do it. I couldn't convince my kids that. They're like, oh, I have to fast. I'm like, you're not allowed to fast. No, but I have to, you know, because then you feel like you're big if you fast. Yeah. So whatever, you get them, whatever, you tell them not to eat at night, whatever. But like, I don't know if it would be a direct issur, but basically it's a form of avelus, which kids are not obligated in necessarily having that form of avelus. So I think it was a hard time convincing my kids not to fast. You know, that's like a rite of passage for them. But the technique is no requirement for them to fast. if you do eat on Tisha B'Av because you have to, you would actually be saying Nachem. The paragraph that we say in our Shemoneh Esrei, you would actually be saying that because you are mourning for the Beis Mikdash. You just happen to not be able to handle the fast, so you're actually still in a state of mourning, and therefore you would be able to do that. The other thing I just want to mention briefly, and that is work. Technically, Shulchan Aruch and Ramah go to this dispute that the minhag is we don't do any work on the morning of Tisha B'Av up until midday, which is about 1 p.m. We don't do any work. So the examples they give are like making beds and sweeping the floor and things like that. But also mean for us that we would avoid doing anything that would take our mind off of mourning in any sense of way, which would really technically mean turning on the news, reading a newspaper, checking the sports scores, other things like that. These are things that one would avoid on Tisha B'Av, aside from the other aspects of things that would take your mind off of it. But we don't go to work on Tisha B'Av, certainly not till midday. If a person needs to, then they would go after midday. But generally, the idea is that people stay home from work during this time. That and it's Sunday, so we're actually pretty lucky that we don't have to worry about that. But these are some of the things that we have. There are other aspects of Tisha B'Av we'll discuss later about shoes and the like, what things you're allowed to wear, similar to that of Yom Kippur. But again, if you're able to do it fully and you mourn for Yerushalayim, for destruction, for our history, that enables us to be part of the rebuilding, and that puts you part of the legacy of past, present, and future with the Jewish people.